Hey guys, Jake with 8020 Media here. Today we are venturing to the not so good old days of diesel engines. While Ford was producing their 7.3 Power Stroke and Dodge was producing their 5.9 Cummins 12 valve, two engines which are widely considered to be the greatest modern diesel engines produced of all times, we had GM producing the 6.2 liter and 6.5 liter Detroit diesel. Now this video is going to go ahead and cover the 6.5 Detroit diesel, a couple common problems with it, and some reasons why this generally is not considered a great diesel engine, especially when compared to its competition of the 1990s and early 2000s. Before the Duramax era, all of GM's engines were produced by Detroit Diesel. It started out with a 6.2 liter in the early 80s, which lasted all the way up until 1992, when GM released the 6.5 liter Detroit Diesel. The 6.5 went all the way from 1992 until around 2002, and it was eventually replaced in your consumer trucks with the Duramax LB7. There was some appeal to the 6.5 Detroit diesel. First of all, it was used in half-ton trucks, whereas with the 7.3 Power Stroke and the 5.9 Cummins, you were only able to get those engines in your HD three-quarter and full-ton trucks. And so this was an engine you could get in your 1500 series pickup, and it also got pretty good gas mileage as well. A lot of these engines were getting upwards of 25 miles per gallon, which made it great from a gas mileage standpoint when you compare them to some of the bigger diesel engines in bigger trucks that were getting low single digits gas mileage wise. Ultimately, it lacked in a few areas as well. There were six different variations of the Detroit diesel. Some of them were actually naturally aspirated. However, the two most common ones were the L56 and the L65. These ones were turbocharged and the ones that were used in your typical consumer vehicles and consumer trucks made by GM at the time. So there's really two reasons why the 6.5 Detroit diesel does not stand up on the podium next to its competitors. And those two factors are performance as well as reliability. At its peak, the 6.5 Detroit diesel produced 215 horsepower and 440 torque in consumer applications. And this is just underpowered compared to what Cummins and what the Power Strokes were putting out at the time. The engine's really just considered to lack power compared to its competitors. That might not matter so much if you have this in a 1500 truck and you like the gas mileage because you're doing light hauling. However, in the HD series trucks, it just really didn't live up to the competition. Another factor there is from a performance potential standpoint, the 6.5 Detroit diesel was very handicapped from a fueling standpoint. The injection pump on it only ran at 80 cc's compared to 105 on the Cummins and 125 on the Power Stroke. This engine just cannot supply enough fuel for it to be very modification friendly from the factory. And so once you start looking at performance modifications for the Detroit diesel, one of the first things that you're gonna have to address is the fueling limitations. It lacked power from the factory, and it lacked performance potential, which are two things that the Power Stroke and the Cummins did not. On to the second one is reliability. There are a number of common problems that plagued these engines and has led them to not be the most reliable or have the greatest longevity. Jumping into some common problems, one of the most common things is with the injection pump. Now, we did say the injection pump was weak to start with, which is true, but it also had an inherent flaw in the design from 1994 onwards. Previously, they were using a DB2 mechanical injection pump, but in 1994, they switched to an electronic DS4 injection pump that had a pump-mounted driver on it, which is essentially a fancy word for a injection pump control module, but that was mounted onto the bottom side of the fuel pump. in an area that is subject to a lot of excess heat. It was made of plastic, and so the plastic would heat up and melt and cause the module to fail frequently. And additionally, the lift pump would also fail. There were some issues with the injectors as well, but the biggest issue was with the PMD or pump mounted driver. So it is common to go ahead and relocate the location of that just to prevent that from being an issue, especially once the injection pump does fail once. So overall, some fueling related issues with the design of the fueling system, as well as with a couple of the components that were a part of it too. More catastrophically, a problem with this engine was with crankshaft failure. The harmonic balancer was known to fail on it. And when the harmonic balancer fails, the crankshaft breaks, and it actually frequently causes the block to crack when this happens as well. If you experience a harmonic balancer failure, you're probably looking at a completely new engine or just sending the thing to the scrapyard, since it'll take out the block with it and require a new engine. Another problem, a little bit more generic, is with overheating. Overall, the cooling system was just very weak, causes the engine to run slightly higher in operating temperature, especially when towing. These engines were known to overheat. Now, overheating can cause a ton of different issues with head gasket failure and a number of other gasket failures, oil leaks, and things of that nature. The overheating issue with these engines can lead to a number of other problems. Fortunately, in 1996, they went ahead and made some upgrades to the cooling system to address issues with overheating, and that for the most part took care of it. But for 1995 and previous models, you might want to look into cooling upgrades, especially if you tow frequently, just since overheating is an issue and is part of the reason these engines aren't known for their longevity. The last common problem is cracked cylinder heads. Now, this is in part due to the issues with overheating. It's also thought that there were some manufacturing related defects with respect to the casting of the iron in the heads that leads them to crack. Commonly, they'll form hairline cracks in between the valves. Now, this is known to happen on some other diesels as well. It's not necessarily a catastrophic problem, but if those cracks become big enough, you will have to replace the head. There's a couple other lesser common problems that we'll note. There's issues with the wastegate setup, issues with the glow plugs, and as well as with the vacuum pump. So when we look at these problems as a whole, there are some significant problems on this list, like crankshaft failure, and a lot of problems caused by the overheating, which is one of the main reasons that these engines just don't last as long as the other diesels being produced at the time. It still is possible to get these engines beyond 300,000 miles, but I'd say once you start getting past 300,000 miles, you're really probably on the last leg of these engines. And so it's not like your 7.3s and your 5.9s that can go 500,000 plus miles without any major internal issues. The biggest problem here is that the issues with this engine aren't with different engine systems. It's with the crankshaft and with the cylinder head and with the block. And so a lot of the problems that this engine has are with major engine components, which is just why we don't see these things lasting as long. It's hard to call one of these engines bad for making it to 300,000 miles, but I'd say part of the other reason that this got such a bad reputation is just because of what it was competing against. You know, I know I've mentioned Power Stroke and Cummins a lot in this video, but you know, when you have an engine like this that's competing with some of the greatest diesel engines ever produced, it sets the bar pretty high. And ultimately, that associated with the problems that this engine has generally is why this isn't considered to be a great diesel engine. That covers it for our guide on the 6.5 Detroit diesel problems with it and why it's not a great engine. If you like this video, go ahead and click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and stay tuned for more future GM content.